God our Father, you have called us all to be in Christ and following. Help us to hear your call during this time of worship. Inspire us to be yield to the Spirit, to be present to him attentively as he speaks to us, and act in patience with him as we enter more deeply into his sacrificial love for us. When this work of worship is done, may we take our being strengthened to do the work of discipleship in the world.
Our opening hymn is number 682, We Shall Rise Again. Come to me, all you weary, with your burdens and pain. Take my yoke on your shoulders and learn from me. I am gentle and humble, and your soul will find rest.
Almighty ever-living God, lead us to share in the joys of heaven, so that the humble flock may reach where the brave shepherd has gone before, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. are being examined today about a good deed done to a cripple, namely, by what means he was saved, then all of you and all the people of Israel should know that it was the name of Jesus Christ, the Nazarene, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. In his name, this man stands before you, healed. He is the stone rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. There is no salvation through anyone else, nor is there any other name under heaven given to the human race by which we are to be saved. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The stone rejected by the builders has become the cornerstone. The stone rejected by the builders has become the cornerstone. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. The stone rejected by the builders has become the cornerstone. I will give thanks to you, for you have answered me and have been my Savior. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. By the Lord has this been done. It is wonderful in our eyes. The cone rejected by the builders has become the cornerstone. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. I will give thanks to you, for you have answered me and have been my Savior. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his kindness endures forever. The stone rejected by the builders has become the cornerstone.
A reading from the first letter of St. John. Beloved, see what love the Father has bestowed on us, that we may become the children of God. Yet so we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we shall be has not yet been revealed. We do know that when it is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to our God.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia,
alleluia.
with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. A good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. A hired man who is not a shepherd and whose sheep are not his own sees a wolf coming, leaves his sheep, and runs away. And the wolf catches and scatters them. This is because he works for pay and has no concern for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know mine, and mine know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I will lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. These also I must lead, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock, one shepherd. This is why the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down on my own. I have the power to lay it down and the power to take it up again. This command I received from my Father, the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My brothers and sisters, every fourth Sunday of Easter, we have the opportunity to hear about Jesus talk in terms of himself as the Good Shepherd. And that's something that, a title that perhaps many of us are quite familiar with Jesus, that he refers to himself as the Good Shepherd. And because of that, we often refer to this Sunday as Good Shepherd Sunday. And so as we think about Jesus being our good shepherd, we can think about different qualities of a shepherd, how they look after a flock, how they have a different call so that the sheep hear their voice, and also how they care for the flock in and of themselves. And so as we look at Jesus being the good shepherd, what is it that God is inviting us to think about this time around? I think, at least for me, one of the lines that stood out were verses 12 and 13. We're in the Gospel of John, chapter 10. And verses 12 and 13 talk about, and they say this, they say, again, a hired man who is not a shepherd and whose sheep are not his own sees a wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf comes, or the wolf catches and scatters them. This is because he works for pay and has no concern for the sheep. Key line being, he works for pay and has no concern for the sheep. On the one hand, this draws us to think about, what does it mean for us to work for pay? What does it mean to work for pay and pay alone? I don't know about any of you, but I think that there were times in my life before I was a priest that I was definitely working for pay. And a lot of times, maybe some of us can think about the high school jobs that we had, or other small jobs we may have had in a former part of life, where we were working not necessarily because we maybe enjoyed the job, but because we wanted the money. And we worked for pay. So I remember for a time in junior high and high school that I was a paper boy. I also remember working for Dairy Queen for a couple months. I could never get the dip cone thing right. It always fell off in the what you call it dip, and yeah, that was never a good thing for me. And I also worked at Kmart, service desk. So I guess I acquired some people skills as you endure the brunt of complaints and issues and other things. And so, but in all of these things, I felt like I was more or less working for pay. And we know that when we work for pay, we have more of a self-concern or self-interest, and then sometimes that can lead to either frustration, or we get into gossip, or we have discontent for our job, and so on and so forth. So in one sense, we can say, what does it mean to work for pay alone? But then also, on the other hand, if Jesus is saying that a hired person who is not a shepherd, is working for pay and has no concern for the sheep, then what is the good shepherd working for? What is the good shepherd working for? And by that, for that matter, and by that same token, like, what is God working for? What does God work for? And what does that mean for you and me? Well, when we start to read Scripture, a lot of times we start at the very beginning, in the book of creation, right? And from the very beginning, what we're told about God is one who is creating and making things new. So from the very beginning, we hear how God separates light and darkness, how he makes dry land and water, the trees, the birds, the grass, and eventually the crown of creation, human beings. And we see that from the very onset, that God's work is to create, and to create out of the magnitude, out of the generosity, out of this overabundance of outflowing love, that we are made by the love of God, his generosity and desire for us to exist and to bring us into being. We are made out of the generosity of his love. And one of the things that we also see in creation is how when God makes everything, that everything seems to be in harmony, that there's purpose and there's meaning, and that everything seems to be in union, and in union with the Creator. But then we come to know and to see that, unfortunately, sin kind of disrupts all of that and messes it up. And so therefore, our loving God, knowing that he, and out of, again, the generosity of his love, desiring for us to share in what he originally intended, of course, takes on our human flesh. You know, the second person of the Trinity is Jesus, right? And so Jesus, being the good shepherd, picks up that baton, if you will, and desires for us to achieve that same union, what God desires for us. In other words, when Jesus says he is the good shepherd, he's leading and he's guiding us, we can ask ourselves, what is he doing? Why is he this good shepherd? Why does he seek to lead and to guide us? And for that matter, when he says that there are other sheep that do not belong to his flock, then those I must also attend to. What is he trying to say or communicate to us when they hear his voice? Well, one, we see that Jesus is the salvation is not meant for simply the Jewish people, but for everybody. God's great desire, God's great love, that we are all living in union, that God desired for all of us. We hear that voice, we respond to it, and we are of this flock, of this fold. But also at the same time, one of the things that Jesus says is this, he says in verse 16, again, that they will hear my voice. They will hear my voice. What we should think about when we hear that is, what was one of the very first times, that we heard God speaking? What was God doing? Well, as I said before, in the book of Genesis, God was creating. God was creating. And so as the Lord speaks, and whether it be to in teaching or in healing or in any other way, as God speaks, and especially as Jesus speaks, who is the second person of the Trinity, through these words, the Lord is speaking, and we know, words of mercy, words of love, all these things that evoke a new creation, a union with God, in other words, what God had originally intended for you and for me, the harmony, the love, the relationship. And so when we hear the voice of the Good Shepherd, when we hear the voice of God in our prayer, when we hear the voice of God speaking through Scripture, when we hear the voice of the Good Shepherd, we should always ask ourselves, what is God doing in my life? Like, how is God transforming me? How is he drawing me to be a new creation? What is God seeking to do within me and draw me closer into union and relationship with him? What is God doing? When I hear that voice, it's not for naught, or it's not just simply to say, hey, I'm with you. But no, there's a very intentional reason and purpose that God speaks to us. It's very intentional, the reason that we may become a new creation with him, that we may live in union with God in the fullness of his divine life. And so if God is, that is the work of God, then in many ways that should also draw us to think about, what is our work? What is work for you and for me? And for you and me, when we enter into work, and sometimes we think about, you know, our jobs that we have, or that maybe we're retired, or wherever we find ourselves in life, we might think of a job, but also to think about just our day-to-day tasks. Every time that we're called upon to use our gifts and our talents, our time, our treasure, those gifts of stewardship, everything that God calls upon us, every work, every task, what does that mean for you and for me? And not to, you know, just get luxury here, but I think I made up that word too, luxury, not luxury, but luxury. I want to just cite a couple paragraphs from the Catechism of the Catholic Church that sheds light on that very question. And so we hear in paragraphs 24, 27, and 24, 28, it says this to us. It says, a human work proceeds directly from the persons created in the image of God, us, of course. And work honors the Creator's gifts and talents received from him. It can also be redemptive by enduring the hardship of work and in union with Jesus, the carpenter of Nazareth, and the one crucified on Calvary. Man collaborates in a certain fashion with the Son of God and his redemptive work. He shows himself to be a disciple of Christ by carrying the cross daily and the work he is called to accomplish. Work can be a means of sanctification and a way of animating earthly realities in the spirit of Christ. In work, the person exercises and fulfills in part the potential inscribed in his nature. And so, one of the things that we hear is that when we enter into human work, into human labor, we are called, it is not for naught, it's not just simply for our enjoyment, but also it is one way in which we can see how the Good Shepherd leads and guides us. And the same concern and intention that we are called to have, that when we enter into labor and to work in this world, we do so using our gifts and our talents that we receive from the Lord, and that we give glory to the Lord, and we enter deeper into the mystery of God, whether it be at times of joy in which we are simply animating our gifts or our talents, but even also sometimes when we enter into, as we know, work can be sacrificial and redemptive. And when I think about work being sacrificial and redemptive, it not only speaks to the dignity of God's love working within us, but I also think of like someone like my dad, who I don't know if I really ever had a conversation with my dad about his job growing up. He's since retired, but he was a day laborer for my family business that made like commercial soaps and other things like that, but industrial cleaners. But nonetheless, like he did, you know, hard, laborious work every day, and I don't really even know if he really liked his job. But what I do know is this, that every time he talked about work, he didn't talk about work in and of itself, he talked about how it put a roof over my head and my sister and brother and my mom, how it put food on our table, and how he would even make certain decisions about, like, do I buy new clothes, or is there something I need to do for, like, me or one of my siblings, you know, so, or somebody, or my mom, or somebody else in, you know, in our larger family, or whatever. But everything that he did was, that sacrificial, redemptive work of living for the families, of purpose, and so there is meaning and purpose there. And again, speaking to the dignity of our human work, again, whether it's just simply expressing our gifts and talents that give glory to God, or it's the ways in which we enter into sacrificial love for one another. But it is through the work and our concern and what that work is oriented towards. There's another way in which we may not think of it as at first, but it's another way in which the Good Shepherd leads and guides us. Whereas the Lord lays down his life for us and has concern for us as the sheep, we, in the dignity of human work, that even popes have spoken about through various encyclical letters, that as we enter into that itself, when we think about our own work and what God tasks that God calls us to, that we are guided by the Good Shepherd, when we place that same focus and understanding and intention, what am I working for? What am I working for? Whether I'm at home, my job, my vocation, or my family, etc. And as we think about what the activity of God's work and our work in this world, may we think about this, and again, put this in the lens of the Good Shepherd, when we hear his voice. In all things that we do, may we hear not only the voice of the Good Shepherd, but may we also ask ourselves, and as we hear the word of the Good Shepherd, his voice, and as we enter into our daily tasks and work and what we're called to be concerned about, again, to think about how is God bringing about his new creation in my life? How is God making me a new creation? And also, how am I giving glory to God through the gifts, the talents, and sacrifices I enter into? And lastly, and above all things, because this is the intention from the very beginning, that as I hear the voice of the Good Shepherd, and I'm a co-worker in the vineyard with the Lord, how is it that the Lord is leading and guiding me in such a way that I'm living in union with the Lord, his intention, and his great love for you and for me, today and always? I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men, for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate to the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with Scriptures. He ascended to heaven, and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Place our trust in the Lord as we now present to him our prayers of intercession.
Our response is, Lord, hear our prayer. That pastors and ministers guide their flocks with tender care, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That governments carefully guard the safety and quality of food and water, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That Christians spread the peace of Christ and the joy of Easter in every time. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Benjamin Bishop, who will receive the Holy Eucharist for the first time this weekend, and for his parents and godparents as they support him on his faith journey, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the members of this assembly share God's abundant feast with those who cannot be here, especially the sick and homebound, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And that we may intercede for one another as we mention our many needs and intentions in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, in your merciful love, we ask you to hear these our prayers and to grant them according to your will. We ask all this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our second collection is for the capital of Griffith.
Our offertory hymn is number 467, Come to Me.
Come to me, all who labor and are heavy burdened, and I shall give you rest. Take up my yoke and learn from me, for I am
joy through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
Just our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all, to love you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. By the oblation of his body, he brought the sacrifices of old to fulfillment in the reality of the cross, and by commending himself to you, for our salvation, showed himself the priest, the altar, and the lamb of sacrifice. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy. Every land, every people exalts in your praise. And even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim.
Holy, holy,
he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." Similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." A mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered to one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Edward our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life. We may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
Not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Be sere, rei nobis. Be sere, rei nobis.
Our communion hymn is number 344, Gift of Finest Wheat.
You satisfy the hungry heart with gift of finest wheat. Come give to us, O saving Lord, the bread. Is not the cup we bless and share, the blood of Christ outpour. Do not one cup, one loaf declare our oneness in the Lord. You satisfy the hungry heart with gift of finest sweet. Come give to us, O saving Lord, the bread of life to
Let us pray. Look upon your flock, kind shepherd, and be pleased to settle in eternal pastures the sheep you have redeemed by the precious blood of your Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Just a couple announcements, or a few announcements, before we conclude today. There's one last opportunity to buy raffle tickets for a spring raffle. The drawing is going to take place tomorrow in Nova, so those will be on sale after Mass. And then just these other two announcements pertain to Litchfield. And one is that our cleanup day in Litchfield is going to be Saturday, May 4th at 9:30 here at the site. So please, if you have any questions, reach out to Kate Chilick. But we are in need of help, all hands on deck, to spruce up our place for the spring here. And then also, last but not least, here in Litchfield in particular, at both Masses, we are in need of coordinators, lectors, commentators, servers. So if you're interested or can help in any of those ways, please let me know, let Sandy know, let Barb Mengus know, and we will give you training. We are good shepherds here. We will not throw you to the wolves. Thank you. So please say yes to that. We are certainly in need of people to help with all these ministries, and we don't want folks to be burned out either. So. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us go in peace to love and serve our Lord.
Thanks be to God. Our closing hymn is number 447. How can I keep from singing? My life flows on in endless song.
Since love.